So similar kind of questions have been asked, and in fact, if I tell you the answer, money market, then there were questions on the money market instruments. Hello everyone, welcome to Plutus IAS. I am CA Sonali Jindal. Today we will discuss UPSC Prelims 2024 economy questions. We will look at what type of questions have been asked. We will also see from which topic these are being asked and what is the relevance of previous year questions in this, and how you can strategize your future preparation based on the 2024 paper. On the screen, you can see the first question. It is saying, with reference to the Indian economy, collateral, borrowing and lending obligations are the instruments of. It has given the four options. So basically, they are directly asking, it is linked to which of the market. In previous years also, we have seen such kind of questions in which they have asked about the banking operations, and in fact, sometimes they have asked, it is seen in the context of what. For example, Amber Box was asked for the WTO. So similar kind of questions have been asked, and in fact, if I tell you the answer, money market, then there were questions on the money market instruments. For example, there were questions on treasury bill, they have asked about that, and in fact, commercial paper, certificate of deposits. So in the future, past year questions, they have asked about the money market instruments. I have already told you, they have asked about the treasury bill, certificate of deposits and the commercial papers. These are the few of the money market instruments that has been already asked. You need to read other money market instruments as well. But before that, let me tell you what is the difference between the money market and capital market. Firstly, we are talking about financial instruments that are being traded on the particular market. First is money market, and the other thing is capital market. On the money market, generally short-term instruments that is less than 1 year are being traded. On the capital market, more than 1 year are being traded. For example, here comes the stock market, bond market. Generally, the holding period is more than 1 year. And here comes the treasury bill, certificate of deposits, commercial paper, call money, notice money that are linked to basically bank. And here the regulation is done by RBI. And through the money market only, RBI is making the money supply and applicable money monetary policy. So basically, RBI is implementing its monetary policy and able to maintain its money supply through the money market. Then the capital market, it is being regulated by SEBI, Securities Exchange Board of India. I hope the difference between the money market and capital market is clear to you. Under this, they have already asked about the equity and bonds. In that year, I think in 2022, they asked about whether it is a capital expenditure or the revenue expenditure. So it means from this question, the learning is you need to read about the money market instruments and the capital market instruments. At least you should know their name and try to see its basic features. Next time they can ask this in detail. You need to read about it. Firstly, I want to tell you, it is just like a treasury bill. What is the mechanism here? So basically, lender who is giving the money on the loan to the borrower basically purchases that instrument, it buys the instrument, and in return it gives the money. obviously on the maturity, what will be the basically conclusion? Borrower will pay back the money and these instruments will be matured off. So this way it works. But in the treasury bill, there is no collateral as such, but the name suggests it is having the collateral in return of the money. So basically lender gets the any of the asset as a collateral. It may be property or something. So it is a secured instrument. So in return of the treasury bill, there is no collateral as such, but for the collateral, borrowing and lending obligations is secured one because it is given against the collateral. I hope you are able to understand what is money market and capital market, and there are different instruments that needs to be read, and this question is indicating towards that. In fact, in the previous year question analysis, you should see other options as well. Like you should know what is a bond market. I've already told you they are focusing on the equity and bond market. Now I have told you capital market is further divided into the equity and bonds. In a simple words, I want to basically tell you equity is something you are becoming the owners, and bond is something you are just acting like a bank. You are acting as a lender, not a owner of that. So hopefully you must have a DMAT account on that. What shares are traded, these are treated as a equity, and the bond acts as a loan, just like a loan by the bank. You must have heard about the government securities, government bonds, or it could be a debenture if it is issued by any private company. So next time they can use the word instead of bond, they can use the debenture word. So you should understand the difference between equity and debentures. In simple words, try to remember this. Equity are the owners and debentures or the bondholders are the basically lenders. Then the forex market, you need to read about it, and the stock market, the basic concepts need to be covered. In fact, in the past they have asked about it in detail. In fact, in the later questions we will see how the focus has been increased on the stock market. They have asked about the beta, what is beta. In 2023 they have asked about it. So I hope the demand of the question is clear to you and you are able to decide from this question what is need to be read more for the future examination. So topic is financial market. I will show you again and again how the UPSC is focusing on the financial market. Before that, before moving to the next question, I want to tell you there is a Indian financial system that is further divided into financial markets. I have explained it to you, capital market or the money market. And there are financial market instruments that are, it could be money market instruments or the capital market instruments. There are financial services. It could be banking services that is being provided by the banks. It could be insurance services, pension services, different kind of financial services. And then there are financial regulators. That is SEBI, that is regulating the capital market, and the RBI, it is regulating the money market, and the banking sector, IRDA, that is regulating the insurance. Then you can also read about the PFRDA, that is basically regulating the pension funds. Apart from this, there are financial institutions. These are further divided into banking and non-banking. Non-banking in this, you need to read about the NBFCs. If you will try to read your economic syllabus in this format, you are able to decipher with what topics are need to be read. You should know about the Indian financial system because UPSC is focusing on this. And in fact, only the Indian financial system, the only the robust Indian financial system could convert the savings into the investment, and that is our target, so that investment could convert into the gross fixed capital formation and further to the GDP. I hope Indian financial system clear to you, And with this, you can think of the topics that needs to be covered. I have already explained you CBLOs. Next time they can ask who operates them. They are basically operated by the CCIL, Clearing Corporation of India, and the RBI. This is also basically under RBI. And this is like a treasury bill. I have already explained to you. It's a short-term market instrument because it's a money market instrument. Moving to next question. It says, first statement is saying, USA were to default on its debt. I hope debt word is clear to you. It's just like a bond or debentures on which basically it's a loan taken by the USA. Debt holders of the US Treasury bonds will not be able to exercise their claims to receive the payment. So basically it is saying, if USA will default on the debt, then the bondholders will not be able to exercise their claims to receive the payment. Obviously, if it will default, then how they will exercise? Next statement says, the US government debt is not backed by any hard assets, but only by the faith of the government. Which one of the following is correct? It is basically asking you about the concept, whether you know about the fiat currency or not. Let me show you, it is linked to the money and fiscal policy. Basically, fiat currency is the currency that is issued by any government and it is not backed by any of the physical asset or the commodity, but it is backed by the government who has issued it. Basically, it works on the faith. And in fact, if you were able to differentiate here between the treasury bills and the collateral borrowing and lending obligations, so this was in news due to the default by the US on the bonds. That's why it came into the news. That's why they asked about the counterpart of it, that is collateral borrowing and lending obligations, because there is no collateral given under the treasury bill. Same thing is here. Under this, US government debt is not backed by any of the hard assets. That means no collateral is given, but it works on the faith of the government. So second statement is true. And second statement, basically, explanation of the first statement. That way you can answer this question. I hope first and second question you are able to interlink them. Here I want to say, it is linked to the fiat currency. Like if you are able to understand this topic, then you obviously can solve this. And the second topic you can mention here is current affairs. So whatever is going in the current scenario, you have to understand that concept and you should know how to interlink with the previous year questions. Okay. Moving to next question, it is saying, consider the following statements in respect of the digital rupee. Again, it is asking about the currency. We have seen the last question was also on the concept of the fiat currency. And in fact, it has been derived from the previous year question that was asked on the CBDC. As the recently central digital currency has been issued, that is based on the concept of the digital rupee. If you have seen this previous year question, then this question is like a cup of tea for you. It is saying it is a sovereign currency issued by the RBI, alignment with its monetary policy. Of course, it's a sovereign currency and issued by the RBI because your fiat currency in the basically physical currency is also issued by the RBI. It's just a counterpart in the digital form. And in fact, RBI has explained it in this format only. So RBI has said CBDC is just like a digital format of the physical currency. Next, it appears as a liability on the RBI's balance sheet. Here, for this question, the basic difference between the asset and liability. I hope it's clear to you. And in 2019, they have asked this concept. They have asked like whether the deposits in the banks, these are liability or the asset. What it is? For the asset or liability, I want to explain it to you. This is the most basic concept. So we were discussing what is asset and what is liability. In simple terms, you need to understand if in future you will get some benefit, like there will be some future economic benefit out of that particular thing, then it is an asset. But if there will be a future loss or future expense will be there, then it is liability. Simple. For example, you as a person go to the bank depositing money of rupees 100. Now, obviously, you are not giving it as a gift to the bank. In future, you will obviously demand it. So, for the bank, it has to return it to you in the future. So it will be a future expense or the future loss to the bank. Then it is a liability for the bank. On the contrary, for the X, it will be an asset because in future it will get benefit out of this deposit. Maybe it will like get some 6-7% return on this deposit. So this way you can remember, asset is something on which you will get some benefit from in the future, and liability is something on which you have to incur some expense or the loss. You can think of the loan same way. Mr. X goes to the bank to get the loan. Now, in the future, bank will get this loan in return in the future, and it will also charge some interest. So it will be an asset for the bank and it will be a liability for the Mr. X because it has to pay back in the future. This way you can solve it. It appears as a liability on the RBI's balance sheet. Obviously, whatever the currency being issued by the RBI, it is the liability on the RBI, like it has to pay that amount of money to that citizen. So if you are holding any note, you can see it says like RBI governor is liable to pay back that money to you. So it is a liability on the RBI's balance sheet. For this question, I would say try to replace it with your normal physical currency. Then it will be very easy for you as it is just in the digital format. Now in the next point, it is saying it is insured against the inflation by its very design. If you know digital currency is just a counterpart of the physical currency, then how it can be insured against the inflation? Because for the physical currency, there is a monetary policy by the RBI to regulate the inflation in the economy, then there is no need of monetary policy if it has to be insured by the inflation. So this statement can't be right. This way you can eliminate third and you are left with A, C and D. In fact, if the first statement is right, this way you can eliminate the C option. Now only A and D is left, but still we have to read the fourth statement. Fourth statement says it is freely convertible against commercial bank money or cash. Obviously, if it just basically in the digital format, just like a physical currency, then it should be convertible against the commercial bank money or the cash. So answer will be D. I hope this concept clear to you and you are able to decipher from the previous year question of CBDC. It has been asked and how this question can repeat itself. And this point is being repeated of the 2019 question. It is asking about the liability. I hope the difference between asset and liability is clear to you. Here the topic, money, banking and the RBI. You can see how much importance has been given to this topic. They are asking about the currency, money and banking. Again, Third question. It is saying syndicated lending spreads the risk of the borrower default across the multiple lenders. I will tell you, in 2019, I guess, they asked about the committee of the creditors. Committee of creditors, it is a concept that is being discussed in the IBC, that is the Insolvency Bankruptcy Code. There was a concept of the committee of creditors. What it says, like, if one loan is basically lended by many lenders, like for example, three or four banks together lends the money to particular person, then if there is a default on that loan, then there is a need of the consent of those creditors for that particular loan. In this, around 75% consent is required if there is a basically insolvency with regard to that, or the default has been incurred. In this, it is saying syndicated lending spreads the risk of the borrower default. Similar thing is happening here. So basically, if there are multiple lenders, then they are able to manage their risk, because in this case, only one lender does not have to bear that particular cost. So I hope syndicated lending is clear to you. In fact, in the future years, they might ask about the what is syndicated lending. So it must be learning from the previous year question. Next question, next statement says, the syndicated loan can be fixed amount, lump sum of the funds, but cannot be a credit line. Although this is a very effectual kind of thing, there can be scenario where this can be specified, but it is not basically indicating towards any of the country or any of the law as such. They are asking general, okay, it can be for the fixed amount or the lump sum amount, but cannot be the credit line. In such type of statements, generally these are considered to be wrong. So this way, if you just basically consider this statement as a wrong, then you can definitely mark C. In this question, even if you don't know about the what is syndicated lending, but with the analysis of the previous year question, there should be a mind as such, like how to basically read the statement, how UPSC asks particular kind of statements. This way you can be in the position to eliminate statement 2. Syndicated lending, I have explained to you, it's a type of loan where multiple lenders work together to provide a loan to the single borrower. I hope it is clear to you. Moving to next question. It is saying Digital India Land Record Modernization Program. I would categorize this question as a basically economic schemes, but why it was asked? Because the similar kind of scheme, Swamitva scheme, it was in news throughout. As in this also, they are doing the mapping of the village land. In fact, if you see, I have already told you, there are different factors of production: land, labor, capital and entrepreneurship. And in the land, there is a problem. There is a failure of the land reforms. There are no digital records of the land as such. There are delays in the land acquisition. That's why government is working on building the land banks and building the agro stack for it. And now this is a very old program that works on making the digitalization of the land records. There is a counterpart in the Karnataka with the name of the Bhumi project, in which Karnataka has digitalized the land records. So basically, Digital India Land Record Modernization Program, we are just digitalizing the land records. In this, we are using the high-end technology. We are using the maps. You can see, to implement the scheme, central government provides the 100% funding. I know for this statement, it should be clear to you, this is a very extreme percentage. In this, you have to know whether it is a central sector scheme or the central sponsored scheme. This way only you can solve this question. So first statement is dicey for you. Next statement says, under the scheme, basically cadastral maps are digitized. Under this, basically proper dimension is given for the land And in fact, sometimes the ownership of land also mentioned in that map. And then initiative has been undertaken to transliterate the records of the right from the local language to any of the languages recognized by the Constitution of India. In this question, I want you to apply your mind. If there is a discussion, like there is a problem that records are available in the English language, if these land records are not provided in the other Indian languages, then how it will work? So generally, this is basically a focus area in any of the schemes. Whenever you read any of the scheme, you need to see like what are the common features that are being focused by the government. They are focusing on the e-governance that basically solves the problem of language. So it could be right. So I want you to include at least third statement. And second statement is basically under this scheme, they are making the maps. It is need to be considered right, then the basically speculation needs to be done in the exam. Whether you will consider this statement as right or wrong, but at least you should be able to eliminate the two options, that is A and C. This way you will be left with B and D. But here comes the need of factual knowledge. You need to analyze what is going in the current affairs and what is being discussed and what is the common problem. In fact, in GS3, they have specifically mentioned in the main syllabus, that is land reforms. It gives you enlightenment that if you just keep on preparing for the prelims and you will not focus on the main syllabus, then your preparation will not be suffice. There is a need of integration of preparation. You need to prepare main syllabus directly so that if question appears from that in the prelims. In fact, I have seen numerous questions that is asking about the main subject. They are asking about the analytical concepts. You need to read about them. Moving to next question, it is asking about the total fertility rate. Firstly, I want to tell you, in prelims, they have specifically mentioned about the demographics. They have asked about the demographics. It is specifically mentioned in the prelims syllabus. Second thing, in previous year question, there are lot of census questions has been asked and it was in news throughout, and population rate is being discussed again and again. In fact, GS1, population issues is there in the main syllabus in the GS1. So it is very expected question, and they have not asked even the fact. They are just testing the basically basic concept. It is a NCERT level knowledge. Although it was in news as the total fertility rate, it is considered to be basically now it's a 2, but replacement level fertility needs to be 2.1. So basically today total fertility level is 2, that is less than the 2.1. So generation is not producing enough children to replace itself. In simple terms, like there is need of at least 2.1 children to be born to replace every person. But actually the birth rate is only 2. This way you can explain average number of live births a woman gives during the basically fertility age. Now you can see the number of children born per 1,000 people. It's not true ke number of children born in the population in the year, number of children born to the couple. No, it asks about the woman. Then it says birth rate minus death rate. Birth rate minus death rate kya hota hai? Birth rate minus death rate, it's basically addition to the population made by this. So it's an average change in the population. Next, average number of live births a woman would have by the end of her childbearing age, that is the fertility age, what number of years, what number of children she will born. So it's a fertility age. So answer will be D. I hope the context is clear to you. Next question, asking about the known banking finance companies. The past year questions, you can see there are numerous questions have been asked on the NBFC. And in fact, if you want to categorize your Indian financial system, I have already told you it comes under the financial institutions, that is further categorized into the banking institution and the non-banking finance companies. It can assess the liquidity adjustment facility window of the RBI. Now, the term comes liquidity adjustment facility. Actually, it is basically testing your knowledge about the liquidity adjustment facility. And on this, UPSC has asked various questions in the past years. So basically, liquidity adjustment facility, under this, repo operations and the reverse repo operations are being conducted. Basically, what RBI is doing here with the trade of the government securities, they are able to regulate the money supply or basically able to regulate the inflation. And with this liquidity adjustment facility, in return, bank has to basically lend their government securities. In these government securities, obviously, NBFCs are being allowed to trade. As the liquidity adjustment facility, government securities can be traded by primary dealers and banks. In this primary dealers, few of the NBFCs are being included. As the statement note saying, all NBFCs can assess, but yes, NBFCs can assess if they are registered as a primary dealer. Primary dealers are those persons or those institutions that are being allowed to trade in the government securities. Next statement says foreign institution investors can hold the government securities. As government is promoting the government securities, as with this instrument, government is able to get the loan. That's why they are opening it for all. And in fact, retail investors are also allowed in it. And in the past, they have asked whether the retail investors can basically trade in government securities or not. This gives you the signal you need to read who can trade government securities. These need to be basically seen in detail. You need to see how these are linked in the liquidity adjustment facility and who can trade in this and how the government securities are helping and why these are to be considered as a money market instrument. These are need to be seen in the detail. And in fact, in the past, they have asked about the difference between FII versus FDI. Basically, if the investment is more than 10%, then it is considered to be FDI. And if it is less than 10%, then it is a FII. Basically, FDI is for the long term. They could fly overnight. And FDI also brings the technology as such and the management. But FII is more focused to get the more returns. So it can hold the government securities. Next statement says, stock exchanges can offer the separate trading platforms for the debts. This question is simply focusing on the government securities and is asking and testing who can invest or trade in the government securities. There was a news that National Stock Exchange has built a, it is a first stock exchange that has built the trading platform for the debts. That's why this statement has been framed. That's why the answer comes to be C. 1, 2, 3 is right. Here you can see it has been asked from the banking and financial markets. Liquidity adjustment facility is a facility extended by the RBI to the scheduled commercial banks, excluding RRBs, that is regional rural banks. Next time they can ask whether regional rural banks can trade or not, and primary dealers to avail of the liquidity in case of requirement of park excess funds. Obviously, you need to read about the repo operations and reverse repo operations. For this, the chapter monetary policy needs to be covered. Then primary dealer, I have already told you, they are being approved to trade securities with the national government. Second statement I have explained, FIIs, they are being basically, they have to get the specific special approval from the SEBI to invest 100% of their portfolio. They can invest in the debt securities, but they have to get the specific approval from the SEBI. Next, NSE has become the first to unveil the separate trading platform for the debts, I have told you. Next question, ninth question, it is saying which of the following can trade in the corporate bonds and the government securities. Similar question. Now you are able to see how the same concept has been tested in two questions and in the same year itself. It is again testing who can trade. If you know the same philosophy, like government is opening for all to trade in the government securities so that the burden on the bank could be decreased. As if the government could be able to basically source funds or get the loan from varied sources, then the basically dependency on the banks will be reduced. Now you can see if the dependency on the bank of the government will be reduced, it will cater the crowding out effect. I hope the meaning of the crowding out effect is clear to you, but let me explain in the brief. Crowding out is a concept in which, due to the government loan, if the government has taken the loan from the banks or the basically market, then there will be a less money available for the banks. So banks will be able to get less money from the basically economy, and if the banks will not be able to give the loan to the private sector, you can think they will not be able to basically invest or create the jobs. And in fact, there could be a chance they have to get the loan from the outside. Foreign loan can be expensive for the private industry. And if there is an increased cost of borrowing, it can lead to the increased cost of production. It can further lead to the inflation. And second thing is, it will not lead to the job creation. That's why government securities are being allowed for everyone to trade in. That's why with that philosophy, answer could be D. So if you will think, I will read everything in every of the topic and then I will be eligible to give the prelims, then that day, believe me, will never come. You need to basically broaden your mind. You need to see what philosophy, on which philosophy government is basically moving. For example, if you see government is more towards privatization. Government is more towards the privatization. Now, let me tell you, in 2019 or the 2020 previous year question, the term statement was given like it on this, it was linked to some payment, digital payment issue or something. In this, the statement was given like this power has been given to only public sector banks. If you know about the philosophy of the government that is based on the privatization, then how it can be on the public sector banks? So the crux is, you need to understand the philosophy of the government, and whatever is currently happening, that will reflect in the answers of the question. So for this, obviously, you need to be updated in the current affairs, then only you will be able to understand. This question also related to the financial markets, and the specific topic is government securities. Now the next question comes, which of the above are considered as the financial instruments? Again, in the Indian financial system, I have told you financial markets and the financial instruments. So financial instruments, what are these? If you just see without any knowledge, like what it could be, maybe you must have some general idea, like it could be some shares or debentures. That way you can at least think motor vehicles are not financial instruments. These are not at least financial instruments. That way you could eliminate and you will be left with 1, 1 and 1, 3. then exchange trade funds and currency swap. There could be a scenario like you might think whether the currency swap is a financial instrument or not, but you can think of like there is some swapping of the currency. This way you can answer what I am saying. Although I know the meaning of the financial instrument should be clear to you if you are a sincere student appearing for the mains, sorry, prelims. But yes, in the main prelims stage, whenever you appear for it, at least your mind should be in as such, like you should be able to at least eliminate motor vehicles. That way you will be left with A and D. After that, there is a guarantee you will definitely mark D. Let me explain the financial instrument to you. It is basically a contract between the individuals or the parties that holds a monetary value. You can think of shares like it's basically a document in which we are saying okay, like I am a person, I have invested 100 rupee or the 1000 rupees in your company and you need to return it with me. Next, they can be either created, traded, settled, modified as per the individual party requirements. Financial instruments can be further divided into derivative instruments and cash instruments. So, they have already asked whether it is a financial instrument or not. Next time, they can ask whether it is a derivative instrument or the cash instrument. They have already asked about the equity and debt-based financial instruments. I have all told you, equity-based are those in which ownership is created and debt-based are those on which just a loan has been given. This is just a liability for that person to pay back to you. But you don't own this company. There is basically a fixed interest rate, but there could be a high returns as such. Now the next topic can come on the derivative instruments or the cash instruments. Let me explain it to you. So basically, derivative instruments are those in which there is a value driven from some underlying asset. I don't know whether you know about the commodity market or not. In fact, in past, they have asked about who regulates this commodity market. Earlier, it was basically comes under, there was some specific institution that was regulating it, but now it is being regulated by the SEBI. So they have already asked about the commodity market and they have asked about the financial instrument. Next year, the question can appear on the derivatives. This should be the analysis of the previous year questions. This on this level you have to see your previous year questions again and again to analyze whether you are reading the right book or not. So commodity market, in this basically trade could be on the wheat. What they do is it's a basically an instrument. It says I will sell it to you on the 100. So basically there are call and put options. Let me explain in simple terms. For example, a buyer comes. He says, like, I will bet that wheat price will increase. So it is saying, I will buy this instrument at 100. So it is basically contemplating that its price could increase or decrease. This way, basically in the future, if the wheat price is increased, like it could say 100 per kg, he is basically ready to buy wheat at this level, 100 per kg. But if in the market, he would get at 80 per kg, then obviously he will not exercise his option. What he will do? He will go into the market and get that money. But if in the market the actual price comes to be 120 per kg, then it will be beneficial for him to get this wheat from here. But in actual, there is no trade of the wheat, only the difference is being settled. So in this scenario, if the price decreased to 100, then instrument will not be exercised by buyer. So there will be no profit or loss for him. But if the price gets 120, then he will get 20 in return. It also helps in the hedging of the price. Hedging is basically to reduce the risk. I hope you are able to understand how instrument is driving its value from the underlying asset. Here the asset is wheat. I hope it is clear to you what is derivative instrument. Cash instruments are directly settled in the cash, and financial instrument is clear to you. It's a basically document that holds some monetary value. It is a contract between the individual parties. Moving to next question. It is a basic concept NCERT level question. 9th class NCERT includes this topic where the sectors are being defined. I hope it is clear to you, sectors of the economy further divided into primary, secondary and tertiary. Primary sector deals with the basically primary products, and here the basically primary products are being traded. It could be agriculture, which is producing the cotton maybe, or it is linked to dairy farm, or it could be linked to the mining. So basically we are extracting or basically exploring the normal natural resources. Then comes the secondary sector. What it does, it basically processes these primary products. So in secondary sector, there is a need of processing primary product. So here comes the manufacturing part. But in the tertiary sector, it provides the support services to these sectors. It could be traders. Like for example, there is a shop that is selling the basically fruits and vegetables. Then it will be a tertiary. It is providing the support service. It could be selling the manufactured product. Then also he would be called as a trader. Then wholesaler also comes into it. Other support services could be services sector. For example, accounting services, a CA is doing, a lawyer could be a service sector, education sector, health sector, all these are services. And in fact, the R&D sector comes under the tertiary sector. I hope it is clear to you. Processing of the primary products come under the secondary sector, and the support services to these sectors are being provided by the tertiary sector. If it is clear to you, let me show you the question that is being asked. First statement says storage of the agriculture produce. If it was saying production of the agriculture produce, then it could be primary, but it is asking about the storage. So basically infrastructure, logistics sector, they are asking about the storage, warehouses, transportation, whatever it could be. In fact, marketing of the agriculture produce, all these are tertiary sector. These are sports services. So first can't be right. Next, dairy farm. Obviously, this is a primary product production. So it is a primary sector. So this is right. Next is mineral exploration. Here comes the basically confusion. Actually, mining comes under primary sector. But mineral exploration, here there is a need of basically some research for saying like there is a mineral you can extract, then the part of mining comes. So basically there is a need of some engineers who could test and who basically see whether mineral is present here or not. So it could be oil exploration or any kind of the mineral exploration. There is a need of some testing facility. So it is a tertiary. This question was done wrong by the people by considering the mineral exploration under the primary sector, but the mining sector under the primary sector. So this is also right. Then weaving cloth, obviously it is processing the primary product. It could be wool or it could be cotton. So this is a secondary sector. So you can see three are right. So answer will be C. So basic concept of the economy, NCERT level question. You can see mineral exploration, if we see the literal meaning of exploration, it is a range of activities that help to determine if there are minerals under the ground or not. It includes mapping, surveying, testing, drilling. So there is a need of some research needs to be done, whether the mining is possible or not, whether it is beneficial or not. That's why mineral exploration comes in the tertiary sector, because it is a providing a support services to the primary sector, that is mining. It is also basic concept of the economy, testing the difference between fixed capital. Believe me, you need to open the 9th class NCERT that has explained what is the difference between fixed and working capital. In fact, in the past, UPSC has asked whether the particular invest, basically expenditure done, is a physical, fixed or investment. So basically it has asked whether the particular expenditure is an investment, public investment or not. You can see they have mentioned like loan waiver is an investment or not, whether it is a short term or long term. So the basic difference here needs to be understood, that the working capital is basically considered to be for the short term and the fixed capital is for the long term. In fact, there could be working asset or the fixed assets. Let me explain what is the difference between the fixed and working capital. You need to open the 9th class NCERT. Basic difference is fixed capital is for long term. It could be like, for example, if any person wants to open his business, what he wants, obviously he needs to have a land that will stay with him for the long, maybe 10 to 15 years. Matlab, he is owning some building. But then he will get some machinery that will also stay for 10 to 15 years, maybe. Or there could be a furniture bought by him. And in the same plant, maybe he is having some products, finished goods, that is the products that are to be sold by that person. Obviously, these will be sold in 1 month or 2 months maybe. So this, the expenditure on it will be working capital. So you just need to think whether this capital or the expenditure will help you in the short term or the long term. Think about the creditors. I hope the difference between the creditor and debtor is clear to you. If it is not clear, please mention in the comment section. But of course, if the payment is need to be done with the, basically if you have purchased the raw material from a person, basically he is called as a creditor. To him, obviously payment will be need to be made within a 2 or 3 months maybe. It will depend on some credit period given by him. It is also working capital. Same way, if you have sold the goods to a person, he will give you that money in 2 to 3 months maybe. So whatever the basically money is linked to less than 1 year, then it will be categorized as a working capital. And if it is more than that, then it will be a fixed capital. Farmer's plow. Obviously, a plow is an instrument used by the farmer for many number of years to do his agricultural activity. So it will be a fixed capital, not a working capital. But if they mention seeds, obviously it will be used for that particular period only, then it will be categorized into the working capital. Computer, obviously it will be used for more than 1 year, then it is a fixed capital. Yarn used by the weaver, you can think of it, a weaver obviously will not keep that yarn for more than 1 year. He is going to convert that process, that product, to make some cloth or some dress or maybe whatever kind of thing. So it can't be a fixed, it will be a working capital. Next, petrol. Obviously, petrol. You can think of your car. Like after every 10 days, we have to spend on a petrol. It can't be a fixed capital. It is a working capital. Then it is true. So answer is B. I hope the difference between fixed and working capital clear to you. Moving to next question. 13th question. It is saying with reference to the rules imposed by the RBI, while treating the foreign banks, consider the following statements. I know this is a factual question. You can't prepare beforehand at least this question, but you can think of some statement. You can at least solve 50% this question. First statement says there is a no minimum capital requirement for the wholly owned banking subsidiaries. Basically, how the foreign banks operate here? Firstly, they could be basically opening the bank here itself, and if the foreign investor is investing in that is considered as the foreign bank, and there could be a chance in the foreign bank could open its wholly owned subsidiary. I hope the wholly owned subsidiary is clear to you. Basically, wholly owned is means the foreign bank is having the 100% capital of this particular bank that is being opened in India. So that foreign bank is holding the 100% capital of this subsidiary. Do you think there could be no minimum capital requirement as such? Even for the small finance banks or the payment banks, there is a minimum capital requirement. So this can't be case. At least you can basically able to relate how RBI works, how the RBI regulation comes. This way you could be able to at least eliminate this statement. Then next statement says wholly owned banking subsidiaries, at least 50% of the board members should be Indian nationals. I know this is a factual aspect. In this, you need to speculate whether you want to attempt this question or not. At least you should be able to eliminate first. Then you need to think of the B and D. Here comes the whether you need to attempt this question or not. You have to see how many number of questions have been attempted already by you. Then you have to take the risk. But generally, 50% is limit is there. Like for example, if the government company is there, in fact, there also they have mentioned the 50% limit. Like at least government has to maintain the 50% ownership in the public bank companies. That way you can think it is somewhere linked to that percentage. If it would be 60 or 70, then you have to see that limit. So at least with the 50%, you could take some kind of risk. Now on the RBI website, you will get this information. Minimum startup capital in the wholly owned subsidiary, there is a need of 3 billion and they required to maintain a capital adequacy ratio of 10%. I hope the term capital adequacy ratio is clear to you. They have tested this, try to learn this concept, and they have asked about the composition of the board. Here it is the given. Now next question asks about the corporate social responsibility rules. With means with the GS4, there is a syllabus called corporate governance. So if you have completed the GS4 corporate governance topic, then you must have read about the CSR. In fact, it was in news throughout. And in fact, for the CSR, they have asked, I think, in mains on this question. They have asked in, 2022, they have asked about the corporate social responsibility. In the mains examination, I think in the GS4, they have asked. So it could be linked to the previous year questions of the mains, and in fact, the topic of syllabus of GS4. And this is very general statement. First statement, you can think of CSR rules. Specify expenditure that benefit the company directly, employ or its employees will not be considered as the CSR activities. I hope the term corporate social responsibility, what we are doing here is like we are giving a corporate, a capitalist business, a social responsibility to incur so that the profit motive should be increased. As you know, there are two types of sectors. One is public sector and one is private sector. Private sector basically focus on the profit, but public sector works for the public welfare. So to reduce this, to tackle this problem, the government has brought the concept of the CSR. It has been dealt in section 135 of Companies Act 2013 that says there should be at least 2% expenditure, 2% of the net profit should be spent by the company on some those activities that could benefit the society. It could be, you might be opening some school, you could be providing the free education to the population staying there, you could be investing in the health services. So there could be some expenditure that is benefiting the society. So we are bringing the public mindset in the private sector so that that motive or the capitalist nature of the private sector could be reduced to some extent, and the benefits could be redistributed to the population, to the local population, with that income that is being earned by that private company. So first statement says that these rules specify that expenditure should not benefit the company directly. Obviously, that expenditure should not be as such like it is benefiting the company. For example, if company has opened some training institute and in that training institute it is giving the training to its own employees, then how it can be a CSR activity? So it should not benefit its employees directly, then it will not be considered as a CSR activity. So this is a correct statement. Next says it do not specify the minimum spending on the CSR activities. You need to have that mindset. If there is no specification like how much you need to spend on the CSR, then who will spend? Who will waste that money? So there should be some specification, at least 1% or the 2%. So this statement at least can't be right. Obviously, UPSC wants you to have presence of mind in the exam. You need to have some philosophy and need to understand how what can be made as a rule or the regulation, because you will be the future bureaucrats who are going to frame those rules. At least you should be analyzed, you should be able to analyze whether this particular rule can be made or not. You need that presence of mind. UPSC is asking these questions, that's why. So it is linked to the corporate governance, current affairs, or the main question that is being asked on the CSR. Next question is a factual question, whether it is a greenfield project or not. I will not discuss this question, this is a factual, but it can be linked to GS3 infrastructure topic is mentioned there, and there air linked infrastructure is mentioned there, that's why it can be asked. And in fact, in previous year questions they have asked about the airports and the ports. Last year, 2023, they asked about the ports. This year, they have asked about the airports. Maybe in future, they could ask about the railways. So at least if you are covering the GS3 infrastructure, try to make some notes. But yes, you can not strategize for such type of questions. You have to obviously ignore some questions which can't be, may not be answered in future. But yes, if this same questions or the options will repeat itself, at least you should be able to do that. At least you should know whether these are greenfield projects or not. What are greenfield and brownfield projects? At least the meaning should be clear to you. The new projects, which are basically whole new, there was no basically project was existing earlier, then it is called greenfield. Brownfield projects are those were existing, but the only renovation or the new some reconstruction has been done to that particular project, then it is called as a brownfield project. So difference between the greenfield and brownfield project should be clear to you, and you should know these are, whatever the answer is, that is not a brownfield project. So it is linked to the infrastructure. This was the last question, and I also want to show like there are only 15 questions being asked in 2024, and earlier it was 20, around 22, 20, questions were asked from the economy. Later it reduced to the 18. Now it's 15. Maybe this number can increase in the future. There is no certainty as such from which subject the number of questions will be asked, but in economy at least you will get 15 to 20 questions, and this is a good number in of any subject. And for this you need to analyze the previous year questions. You can't basically rely on the basic syllabus, like you keep on those reading those old books. This will not be helpful to you. You need to re-strategize your syllabus and material, and you need to think there is a need of more focus on the financial markets, money and banking and the financial instruments. You need to focus on this, and in fact this is because there the number has been increased of the investment in the stock market. Economic survey has said like the number of registration of the demat accounts has increased numerously. So basically you need to understand, that's why the focus has been increased. You need to be updated with the current affairs, but firstly you need to have a basic concepts also. In this paper also they have asked very basic questions, the about the sectors of the economy and the fixed and working capital. Again it has shown previous year question analysis needs to be done to decide your preparation level. So, all the best to all of you. I hope this discussion will help you. Thank you.